Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another episode of The Blind Perspective here on Whose Blind Life Is It Anyway? The show where we talk about today's topical news and what we feel is important to talk about. I am your host, Victor Gouvin, and joining us today is Nimmer Jabber. I think you're in California, aren't you?
I am. Hello, Victor. It's been a while, but here I am at last.
What is the weather out there like?
It's probably about 80 degrees or so. It's not too hot. It's about 20, 25, 27 Celsius, somewhere around there.
It must be idyllic out there.
Yeah, it's pretty nice. Yeah.
Yeah. Remember, if you like what you're about to hear, hit that like button and subscribe on YouTube and follow us on our Facebook page and on Twitter. And if you can't catch us live, you can always catch us on podcasts everywhere. We're on pretty much most apps and devices that actually play podcasts, even players, the Victor line of players, and Alexa. So check us out. There's something on this channel for everybody to enjoy. Today's topic is, I guess it's more for creators and content producers of every kind. Not sure if some of you have watched the show Snap that we have on Saturday nights, the Saturday Night Adult Party. It is an adult themed party because we don't encourage anyone under the age of 18 to watch. However, it talks about sex, sexuality, and relationships from a blind perspective. And most of what we talk about is rather informative. We never do anything just to titillate. We don't do anything just to make people horny. But some of the viewers of that show seem to think that Monica, that's Monica Jones, my co-host, and I practice what we talk about. While we do, in fact, share our experiences, if we happen to have them, for the most part, we are simply talking about them. I had two episodes in particular that everybody just flew off the handle over. It was bestiality and necrophilia. Bestiality is about sex with animals, and necrophilia is about sex with dead bodies and or unconscious people. One of the characteristics I told was of a story of myself being at a friend's house looking after his apartment and his dog, and I just had an experience there. It wasn't anything that lasted more than 2 seconds, but it was an experience. And likewise, I spoke about an experience during the necrophilia show about an unconscious woman who I called EMS for, or emergency services for, and I had to stay there overlooking the body in case she got worse or in case something else happened. But apparently, these people thought I was essentially looking at this woman and she was dead and I wanted to have sex with her. It didn't help that I did mention that the woman was completely naked while lying on the floor. But instead of approaching me to ask questions about my experiences and what I was actually saying, they didn't. they actually did YouTube shows not only criticizing what I said, they out and out said that I promoted these lifestyles. Monica and I did. Excuse me. And that what I did was criminal. Even though there is no actual law that says necrophilia is criminal, and believe me, I've checked, I've actually researched this stuff for the show, the fact that I never said I had sex with anyone that was dead. I never said that I promoted these lifestyles. The only thing I did say was that I don't judge these people for having these lifestyles. As long as no one is getting hurt or no beast is getting hurt, who am I to judge? But these people seem to think that I'm allowing this stuff to happen, and I'm allowing, well, in fact, I'm doing these things. So the big question is, do I tailor my shows to conform with people's opinions and people's views? These people, I should say, are cited, and they have absolutely no stake in our channel, save that they view these shows. And but either way, my counter argument was, if you think it, I'm doing something wrong or I'm promoting this stuff, by all means, feel free to report me to Google. No one has, as of yet, done that. At least the channel hasn't shut down. I haven't received any letter of warning or any acknowledgement from Google. So I can only imagine these people have a bigger bark than they do bite. But the question still remains. Do I theme down what I talk about to appease these, well, I don't know what you would call them, I guess, naysayers, I guess, or the audience? As I said, it is the blind perspective. That's what our channel is all about. It's called the Blind Perspective Network. And that's all we do. But is it truly a blind perspective when we're not allowed to talk about what we perceive? Nimmer, you are an actual content producer for your channel, and I will be placing Nimmer's channel in the description box if you guys want to. Feel free to subscribe and check out Nimmer's channel. I think it's Blind Tech Adventures.
Yes, it is.
Yep. Yeah. So, I mean, Nimmer, what do you think?
Well, first of all, I will say necrophilia in a number of states here is actually, in most states, is illegal and punishable by, depending on the state, various penalties. In California, it's definitely illegal. In Nevada, it's up to life in prison. So it just depends on the state. So,
I'm sorry, have you actually read that?
Yes.
Okay, because I checked and there was no such thing.
Well, there's legislation in various states. What's that?
There's abuse of a body's reputation.
No, in
Where
various
that
states there are
really is
laws. In
actually.
California, I'll read to you the exact legislation here. Let's see here. Every person who willfully commits an act of sexual penetration on or has sexual contact with any remains known to be human is guilty of a felony. And then there's it's up to maximum of 3 years in prison, at least here in California. Nevada has similar legislation. Theirs is up to life imprisonment. I can look up other states, but the point is that it is a very much a state-by-state thing here in the U.S.
That's interesting. The article I read didn't say that.
Well, I don't know what article that is, but very clearly, if you look up legislation in various states for it, there's definitely laws for it. There are some states that don't have any laws, but I would say most seem to. So I just looked up a few different states, but yeah, a lot of them seem to. In any case, I think for me it's interesting to talk about this in a broader sense because this topic really shouldn't be about any specific topic as much as it is about the idea of what a creator should do when someone dislikes the content. And I think it seems to me that our society has gone down this road of canceling things and people and deciding that we don't like what people say and whatever. And instead of hearing a person out, we'll just call them out or cancel them or do whatever. And I have problems with that because there's a lot of ideas in the world, and some of them I find absolutely despicable. But I still want those ideas to be out there because there are people who don't find those things to be despicable, people in cultures. And when we kind of go down this road of canceling ideas, I think it's a dangerous path for us to be on. So to limit this more narrowly, I guess, to content creators, if somebody doesn't like something that I say, it kind of depends on how what it is that they don't like. Do they not like it because they just don't like the content, in which case I really don't care, move on. Do they not like it because I'm actually causing harm to a subset of people, in which case I very much care and I'm not interested in causing harm to a certain, I'm not going to start making slurs against Jews, saying that we should kill Jews, for example. I'm not going to say I hate black people and we should kill black people. I'm not going to say I hate white people and white people are evil things that need to be killed. Those, clearly there are certain things that we just shouldn't be saying as content creators, and those kinds of ideas really shouldn't have a place in our world. But I choose to, as a content creator, not share those things. And I know that content websites that host content, YouTube, podcast sites, have rules against racist, bigoted things. And so, there to me, there's a difference between I'm sharing something that you don't like, in which case I really don't care, move on. I'm posting it because I'm enjoying what I'm doing, and this is my content. And if you don't like it, either create your own or shut up and move on. Or and there's a difference between that and the other side of that is, again, posting content that is very much harming somebody.
I think the sites use the term inciting
That's right.
violence.
Yeah, and that can be that too. I don't want to incite any violence. I don't want to incite anybody to go out and attack black people or any other group of people. I don't want to cause harm to children or any other group of people as much as possible. But also, I think that we live in Western democracies and should be able to and have the right to be able to, and I will always fight for the right to be able to say things that, whether you like them or not, have a place to be said.
I mean, the argument that I put out was, are we really free if we can't say what we want to say?
And I don't think we are. I think that as content creators, we do hold some responsibility on our shoulders to make sure the content that we present is accurate, to make sure that it is, it isn't going to be causing harm. But on the other hand, you know, people have gotten to be too sensitive. And it's funny, a lot of times people that are offended at something I say aren't even part of the community that I supposedly offended.
Right.
So frankly, if you don't like something I'm saying, if you don't like my content, I don't care. I don't like you, so move on. You know, I really don't care. It doesn't bother me. It's not going to hurt me if you go and you know, say crap about me or cancel me or whatever. I'm going to keep posting my content because somebody out there wants to hear what I have to say. And I want to advertise and I want to promote my content for those people. If somebody doesn't like what I have to say, well, I'm just very sorry, but too bad. Sorry, but not sorry.
And I can understand if a person is actually making money, you want to do things that other people enjoy and don't criticize as much, but the facts are this.
But see, I wouldn't. Even saying that, if I make money, I want to make money doing something that I enjoy doing. Otherwise, it's kind of a chore. It's kind of a...
I'm not enjoying doing it,
therefore why should I do it? I mean, even a job, you know, I don't typically work jobs that I absolutely despise working. And if I, you know, if I'm making money based on producing content that someone else tells me what I can say, personally, I'm not going to do that. I see others doing it, and that's fine if you want to do that. But like in one example of this, I've worked with this company that is developing this mobility aid, and you know, we've had conversations about content that I put out, but it's not for them to say this is what I can and cannot say. It's not for them to pay me money to say certain things.
Right.
And so, like, for me, my voice is important for me to be able to use it in a way that benefits people, but also I can't not offend everybody. I can't put out content that makes everybody happy, and I won't even try.
What if a company does pay you to say something? Would you?
I mean, personally, I wouldn't take the money. Unless I believed in the product enough to where I was going to get paid to say what I was going to say anyway. If I don't believe in the messaging or the messaging is inaccurate, I wouldn't take the money.
Right. And that's the point, isn't it? I mean, the fact is, we don't get paid for doing what we do here. No one does. If anything, we lose money on it.
I would say some YouTube creators do get paid for what they do, but either way...
Oh, I'm sure, yeah. Yeah, I'm sure. There are guys out there who are monetized beyond comprehension. For example, people on Anchor who have podcasts can get monetized.
Yes and no. They can,
well,
but
people in Canada can't.
Yeah, but...
But it's a, it,
in order
it
to get monetized
to
for podcasting to actually make anything worthwhile, anything that is going
exactly.
to pay back your costs that you're paying out towards your equipment and your costs and everything else, you've got to have
right.
millions of listeners. You've got to have advertiser support. It's not you're not really getting monetized.
No, and you're not. The facts are you have overhead that you need to take care of. And in the end, it all balances out. And if by some great happenstance you happen to make more money than you pay out, then great. I'm happy for you. But some people get into this strictly for the money. Because they think they're going to make tons and tons of money. Well,
they do, and you know what? There are content creators who do. There's, you know, even some blind people. There's like a Lucy Edwards and a Molly Burke. There's a few content creators who are in it to make money, to create content. They,
mm-hmm.
you know, they'll tell you they're putting whatever stories out there, but they're making money, and that's what they're in it for. And you know what? That's their job. That's their profession. That's what they do.
Yes.
I don't listen, I don't watch, I don't have anything to do with content creators like that because I find them kind of sleazy. Not trustworthy and liars. Even if they aren't, even if they are completely credible on a specific topic, the question, the doubt is in my head of, well, I know that this is their job and they're getting paid to do this, therefore
mm-hmm.
I just really don't trust them.
Yeah.
And I've also worked with companies who pay people like that to put out certain messaging. And so I have no trust in content creators like that. So for me, I would never put out content like that, and I would never be that kind of content creator. And therefore,
right.
I'm not going to follow those kinds of content creators. And you know, if you're one of them, more power to you and have at it. You know, that's your job, then I'm happy for you. But that's just my belief about those types of creators.
Yeah, and in my opinion, people who actually watch what they enjoy watching are people who tune into CNN or Fox or for a specific way of looking at things. The fact is, you look at CNN if you happen to be Democratic. You watch Fox if you happen to be Republican. And...
Yeah,
I'm
that's
sorry.
The thing that we are heading down in this society of, you know, we ally ourselves. There's been some studies recently that college students will not date somebody who has different politics than them.
Yes.
They will. And I think that's really sad. You know, when we get to a point where we're shutting ourselves off to different ideas and we're
uh-huh.
not going to follow other ideas and we're not going to know about what else people are saying. And, you know, I think that's really sad, and that's kind of a sign that our democracy is breaking down. When we cancel ideas, when we cancel the ability for people to put things out there, when we cancel people for having certain thoughts and ideas, I think that's a problem. I think it's a bigger problem when we tell companies that they should be part of doing that kind of censorship. You know, and I'm not talking about violence and, you know, very clearly things that shouldn't be out there.
Sure.
But there's a lot out there that's kind of ambiguous that isn't that.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I would hate to live like that. I mean,
well, I think that's what we're living now.
Person
I think that's
haunts.
Where we're living. You know, people have to be very cautious about what they're saying and who they're saying it to, because I've had friends cancel me for saying things that people disagree with.
Oh, no, sorry. I meant I would hate living with someone who constantly agreed with me. Because,
well, I mean,
just think of the conversations. They'd be so boring.
I mean, people say that, but I think people generally typically look for people who agree with them. They typically look for the people that back up their ideas. I mean, that's how we get white supremacist groups.
Right.
Or any, or you know, black power groups or any group like that. You know, we get these fringe groups that are very much a bunch of people or a few people that have similar beliefs, and they draw on each other's energy and strength and voice and language. And you know, the abortion movement's kind of been that way.
Yes.
People get together in massive groups, and they go do these abortion protests, these massive things that are all speaking the same language and marching to the same tune, and you know.
And invariably, they always find someone who's willing to go above and beyond the demonstration.
Yep.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think people look for people who, you know, to ally themselves with, who have the same beliefs. And I think that probably this is kind of normal. That's what humans do. But it's just dangerous when we go down the road of saying, oh, I don't like your ideas, and so I'm just going to cancel you. I don't like your show, so you shouldn't put it out there. And I'll say to any content creator, you know, the best thing you can do is put your middle finger up at those people, because you're doing the best that you can, and you're doing something that you enjoy, and it shouldn't be all about whether or not people agree with you. It should be all about, are you doing something that you enjoy is, you know, giving at least somebody out there something to look forward to?
And that's it. I mean, it's called a blog, people. A blog. People are putting down how they feel, what they're doing. Excuse me. What they're doing, and are you going to dictate what they're doing? It wouldn't be a blog. It would essentially be someone talking about what you want them to talk about. And if you're looking for that, go find it. There are literally
I just saw it come in, but although it came in a long time ago, but I wasn't looking at the chat. So, Misty, I want to apologize to you. Misty came in and sent a message in the chat, said she was sorry she was late. The Colts game went late, but I don't know if she's still here or not. I can't see that because I'm not the stream.
Oh, yes, she's still here. Great.
So my apologies there.
Can you hear me guys now?
We can hear you now.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, like I said, it was my bad because I didn't realize the game was going to go over.
Yeah, I wish StreamYard would play some kind of a ping or something for chats.
But well, they do. I don't know why it keeps breaking down like that.
No. Oh, it never plays any pings for chats for me.
Well, no, this isn't a chat. It's when someone actually comes into the room.
I don't get that unless I'm actually a host, so, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Really? Because other people actually hear it also.
No, I don't hear it unless I'm a host.
That's weird. So, Misty, I'm not sure if you've been following the conversation.
For about the past 10 minutes, 20 minutes, maybe. Oh, excuse me, stretching. But yeah, I mean, so like, okay, my thought on it initially, even though good points were made as well in other and other perspectives and positions, my thought initially was, you know, you target your audience and also try to at least target what they are interested in or not interested in, you know. But as far as the people you're talking about, again, presumably they are sighted people and they're not your target audience anyway. So, yeah, I mean, I just wouldn't really give much thought to those kinds of comments. Now, within our community, I mean, it might be worth giving at least some consideration because, you know, basically you have an audience and you know what audience you're targeting and you know what audience you want to reach. And, you know, so, I mean, those are just my initial thoughts on it.
I mean, the way I look at it, the facts are these. There are literally millions upon millions of websites out there and countless YouTube channels. Right. And I do mean countless. We're not talking a couple of thousand. No, we're talking, is it possibly in the millions, Nimmer? Do you know?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So, if on TV you don't want to watch a particular program, you just switch channels.
Right. Mm-hmm.
It's that simple, really.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree with Misty. I mean, it is good to know who your audience is, but also, You know, just again, if somebody doesn't agree with whatever you're saying, okay. I mean, you know why you're putting the content out there. It's value to you that you're doing it, and hopefully it's value to some of your audience. So,
well, and I think that's the thing. I mean, you know, it's what one person says versus maybe a majority of your audience. I mean, if maybe a majority of your audience is saying, oh, we like this or we don't like this, I think that may deserve more consideration than just say one or two people kind of deal.
Well, it's starting to grow. That's why I was so concerned at first. But I mean, Misty has her own channel, but not only
do anything regularly though.
no, but you've also studied classical
classical studies, religion, text, literature, yeah, everything.
And how many of those classical texts were considered outrageous at the time?
Think about Ovid, y'all. Who got exiled because, well, presumably because of a mistake, as he put it. It's believed that Augustus, at least for show, said, oh, this is immoral. You know, the Ars Amatoriae, for instance, is an immoral text, and so you're going to go into exile. But there's some suspicion that there were some political issues at play as well. But anyway, that's, the first text like that that comes to mind is Ovid. But right. I mean, there are plenty of other authors who wrote even more superfluous things than that. So
I think there's something else that we need to note for creators too, and maybe even for audience members, and is that, and this is the same for companies. This is why companies often pay. It's bad, but they pay for fake reviews. People are a lot less likely to give you a good rating or a good review or a good note or something that they like something. They're a lot less likely to do that than they are to bash you when you put out something that they don't like. Even if 10,000 people like whatever it is that you posted, if 3 people don't like it or 10 people don't like it and they happen to make a lot of noise, that's kind of what messaging gets out there. And because those other 9,990 people, they don't tend to actually review, put comments, positive reviews, whatever. They don't rate you a certain number of stars, you know, whatever. They don't hit the like button. So, you know, it's kind of a thing. Like, if you like content and you like what a creator says, let them know that, because I think that it's really helpful for the creators to know that. But as a creator, you should know that chances are people who don't like you probably aren't the majority of your audience, because the majority of your audience probably aren't interacting with you at all anyway.
Right. And I mean, I think that's the thing. Like, just again, human nature tends to focus more heavily on the negative than the positive. I think that's just the general bent of, again, human nature. I think part of that is because, like, the positive, I would argue anyway, is more an expectation than something negative. And so when something positive happens or someone does something well or whatever, it's not like you feel like you necessarily need to praise them as much as you need to criticize when something negative happens. That's just my theory on it. But
it's true, except that humans absolutely need and flourish on, and animals of all kind flourish on the positivity and the, you know, like babies from the very beginning need people to tell them that they've done a good job and that they look pretty and they, you know, and I don't think that humans change as they get older. Like what happens, it changes, you know, people get less of that, but I don't think that humans necessarily need less of that. I think it's more like they just get less of that, whether they want less of it or not.
Yeah.
And most people don't know how to positively criticize other people.
You mean like constructively?
Constructively, yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's what people focus on, the fact that it's so negative. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can honestly say whenever I review a product on Amazon, not only do I give the bad parts of it, but I also add the positive parts of the product.
Oh, yeah, that's me too, usually, yeah. Unless something's completely horrible. But yeah.
I mean, just the other day, I bought a USB hub that I thought was a USB-C hub with USB-C ports, but it turns out, no, they're USB-A ports.
All right.
But the thing is that most people who put up reviews are putting up reviews because they at least have a few things that they don't like about a product.
Right.
And so, like, on Amazon, there's this huge problem of fake companies paying people to put up fake reviews, or paying them with products or paying them money because real positive reviews are a lot harder to come by. So you get all these products that have like 4 stars or less, even though they might be great products, because a few people got it and they didn't know what to expect, or got it and didn't do what they wanted it to do the right way, or didn't know how to use it or whatever, and so they rated it badly. Even though probably, again, the majority of people use the product just fine and are happy with it, but they didn't, they're not the ones that rate it.
Yeah, and I put down, I mean, one of the first things I put down, for those who are blind, this USB hub has no USB-C ports, except an input.
That's very rare for any USB hub to have actual USB-C
I've got one with a C on the end, actually.
output ports.
Yeah, but
No,
that's
I mean on
the
the end, like the one that you plug into it is USB-C, but
No. I mean actually on like one of the narrow ends, like you have the ports on the wide end, and then say on the other side you have on the wide end you have the one that plugs in your PC, for instance, and then at the end, like the narrower part, it's hard to describe. But yeah, I'm gonna see on there. So.
Yeah, those are called output ports. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean,
Well, I've
that's the
got an
problem.
output port as well, but the thing is with most USB hubs is that those output ports are for charging. So,
Okay.
for example, you can get a USB-C port, and it has we would consider an output port because it's a pass-through, right? So
Right.
it plugs into your USB-C port on your computer,
Right.
and then because a lot of laptops charge with USB-C, you can plug
Oh,
in
I
the
see what you're saying.
USB-C to charge the computer through the USB hub, even though
Right.
the rest of the ports on that USB hub are
Sure, it
actual,
compensates for it.
right.
Yeah, bit tangential, but like the reason I got it was I have a Surface Book 3, and I've had problems with Surface Books ever since I got, and like none of the ports. Like, well, they worked, but like they would disconnect, reconnect, disconnect. I could just move the computer slightly, and so I will never. I just say it right now. I'm not getting a Surface Book again. I had so many issues with the first one, and issues with the second. The first one, the battery, like, yeah, not exploded, but got inflated. You know, expanded.
Microsoft should just leave creating laptops to its manufacturers, to its
Yeah.
OEMs.
Okay, you're not. I'm not the only one then. Yeah, because like
No.
I've heard people say, "Oh, we've had great luck with them," but like, yeah, I've had bad luck with both of the ones that I have had. I'm never getting Surface Book again.
Yeah.
I mean, that is the hardest thing for me, that I constantly have to switch out the cords on my USB-C port.
Okay.
You know, and that's my main complaint. You know, if I want to charge or get files from multiple devices with a USB-C port, I simply can't.
No, there's not really hubs that have multiple USB-C ports like that. There's that I'm aware of anyway. Most every hub's going to have one. If it has USB-C, it'll have one port, and that's usually a bypass for charging, so that you can have it plugged into your laptop and have other devices plugged in, and your laptop will be charging at the same time.
Okay.
But aren't most things coming out with USB-C ports?
These
I
days, like
mean, with USB-C plugs, rather.
they are, yes, but the idea, I mean, that's like usually USB-C, you can have multiple things plugged into one USB-C port because it has quite a bit of power, so.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
Well, yeah, and plus, I mean, it's something that you don't have, it doesn't matter how you put the plug in.
Which
Yeah.
is nice.
You know,
I'm
you
always
don't have
screwing
to
with the
worry about
USB.
putting the plug in the wrong way because it's still gonna work.
Right.
But
Exactly.
still, the majority of people are wanting to use just regular USBs, and so they are using the USB-C port to plug in devices that don't have
That's
USB-C.
interesting. Yeah, I thought the trend was more to the USB-C direction as well.
I mean,
Yeah, I mean.
that's where we're moving to, but there's still a lot of regular USB-A devices out there, so.
Yeah, okay,
And that's the issue, isn't it? The fact that everybody is so unwilling to change.
cool.
And that kind of, you know, that kind of brings us back to what people want to hear and what they don't. Because they don't want to know that their chargers, their 650 block chargers are going to be useless.
I mean, really, if you want a bunch of USB-C ports, you got to look towards a docking station, probably, for laptops.
Oh, okay.
Oh, no. Oh! I never even thought about that.
Right. So, yeah.
And there's your tech for today, guys.
Exactly. Oh dear.
And believe me, I appreciate Nimmer for all he knows.
I know, right? I mean, technical.
He's the most qualified of us to talk about tech. Because Lord knows I know nothing about the tech except the what I know.
Yeah.
So I'll just wrap up my bit. You know, with regards to your show, I would say if you're putting out your show towards a specific audience, and if you care about what your audience is saying, you know, maybe you can poll them or whatever and see get their idea, and if a lot of people are offended with some things that you're saying, you know, maybe consider not saying it. But on the other hand, if you are enjoying what you're saying and you think there's value in it and some of your audience is finding value in it, then maybe just saying to the majority of people at the beginning, like, hey, this is what this topic is. If you don't like it, feel free to turn it off and move on and come back next week.
Mm-hmm. Right. And that's my argument, essentially.
But I wouldn't let it stop you from making content.
Right, and
certainly not from one or two people inside of people with that.
No.
Yeah, and on every episode that these people criticize, I specifically say I'm reading this stuff off of Wikipedia.
Wikipedia is not a very credible.
Whether it's credible or not is not for me to judge. But this is stuff.
If Wikipedia is where you got that necrophilia is legal in every place, then that's probably why. Now we know it's not actually true. But.
Right. Yeah. No, Wikipedia is definitely not the first source that I go to for.
No, I mean, I understand that Wikipedia is completely viewer or.
You know
viewer.
What I tell people about Wikipedia when I teach students? I say, here's the thing. I have taught tech for, you know, a good number of years, like 15 years or something, and I work at Google and in tech. But if you would like, I can do brain surgery on you because, well, I can write a Wikipedia article and I can talk all about brain surgery and how it's performed and everything else and put it out there on Wikipedia. And so therefore, because you've read my article on Wikipedia, now I'm an expert and you're an expert, so now we can all perform brain surgery. What do you think?
My method of research, like, I mean, I will certainly, it's not my first source, like, I will look at other sources first and then I might go there for possible additional corroboration, additional information. But the only time I go there first thing is usually for less, let's say, significant material, pop culture things, things like that. Like, I might just go.
Yeah, I can give you kind of a good summary or a good jumping off point, but I would say, like, especially if it's something that you actually care about, whether it's reliable or not, absolutely you want to have some other resource.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I definitely look at the references at the bottom of the article.
Helpful. Yeah, but again, I can reference my own site. When I write up an article about brain surgery, I could reference some really credible sources, WebMD or some other doctor or whatever, and they might have absolutely nothing with why I'm referencing them, but, you know, I can just say, oh yeah, this is a reference for what I'm saying. Here you go. Like,
right, and you've got to check them, and you've got to also evaluate each source's credibility as well. But,
I think that's a given. Yeah, if you don't think what I say is credible, go somewhere else.
Yep.
I mean, for Christ's sakes, there's PBS. The Learning Channel.
Well, you all have that up there too. Cool. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, there's Discovery. I mean, you don't have to listen to what I say.
Wait, why are we referencing TV channels as a credible source of information?
No, that's true. Anymore.
Well, I never said they were credible. Aliens, I just said they were there.
like ancient aliens in history, just like that's like a perfect example, counterexample of that.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I mean, but it's just unbearable that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think you were talking earlier about how people get paid to say things about a product, and I think those are called influencers, aren't they, these days?
Yeah. I mean, influencers can't get paid. I mean,
technically anybody on YouTube is an influencer in some way, or can be, but yes, usually they're, you know, the people that are paid to influence people's opinions in a specific direction or another.
Right. Right. And it just, I mean, what's the point of getting a product that's being hawked by an influencer if...
Well, I mean, Donald Trump is an influencer.
No,
there's Donald anybody Trump can is a become clown. An influencer. Okay, I'm just saying, like, if somebody speaks well, has a nice voice, you know, they're sexy, they're whatever, they have a couple of nice things to say that someone might agree with, and all of a sudden they become an influencer. You know, people will follow me religiously, you know, every week, same one or two people will comment or whatever, and I'm like, I'm an influencer to them, and I'm like, that's pretty scary, that's a lot of weight to have on one person's shoulders, but hey, you know, I think you know,
yeah, I heard that's the term,
what happens,
right? I heard the term a while back, literally heard the term blindfluencer.
And oh, wow, like, okay, well...
Oh, wow.
Okay, there you go.
Like, someone... And someone
is that like a Mark Riccobono or a...
Right? But no, like, someone... Like, some, I think it's like a Molly... Like, sort of like the Molly Burke people you were talking about. But,
oh,
like,
yeah.
This person, though, had it on their own... Had the hashtag blindfluencer on their Twitter profile, and I'd never heard of them until that day. So...
Jeez.
Just saying.
I mean, I think Mike May has done quite a bit climbing Everest...
Wait, I'm thinking...
I don't think Mike May has climbed Everest.
What is his name?
I think that's Eric Weinmayer.
Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, Eric Weinmayer. I apologize. Yeah,
Mike May is has done some work with GPS stuff.
Oh.
Right. Yeah.
I read a couple. I think I read
Do I look at him to talk about GPS? Do I think he knows what he's talking about? Who knows? All I know is that he climbed a freaking mountain.
Well, they're actually two different people that we're referencing, so I'm definitely don't think Eric Weinmayer knows about GPS.
But well, as an example, would you approach a mountain climber to tell you how to cook something?
I might. I mean, they have to be climbing mountains, so they got to know how to pack right and eat right, you know, while they're climbing. I don't know. You never know.
So you think until you find out he didn't climb all the way.
Oh, I know, no, he definitely climbed all the way. Yeah, no, he definitely.
Oh, did he? I heard he didn't go all the way.
Well, he's not Everest. I don't think he summited.
He definitely summited.
Wait, because like when I read the book, I didn't think he made it completely to the.
No, he absolutely made it to the top.
Unless, wait, was it later after he wrote the thing? Because did he do it more than once?
Yeah, he's been up there more than once, but he absolutely made it to the top.
Okay, that may be why I'm thinking that. Okay.
Well, yeah, then he must have done it. Oh, yeah, he didn't write about it.
I was going to say, I thought the book was before he actually managed to just completely make it to the top, but yeah.
Huh.
Touching the Top of the World, I think it was called, or something like that.
I guess we have to update our information there.
Right. No, I didn't.
But we have to.
Yeah, it's on his website. I'm just looking it up. He did, he definitely summited.
Okay. Mm
hmm. Fifth Continental Summit is what he says.
Okay. Is that in reference to like Asia? Because he's saying continental.
It's in Asia. Yep.
Well, okay. So he's talking about
His ascent was on May 25th, 2001.
Oh, that was actually pretty far back. Okay.
Wow, that was a long time ago.
It's actually when I graduated. The year I graduated.
My daughter was actually a glimmer in my eye at that point.
right.
But I have to ask you, Nimra, how the hell do you do that?
How do I do what?
You're carrying on a conversation and
I can't multitask
researching
like that either,
at the same time.
Oh, I don't know. I guess I just got used to it.
Like, no, I'm horrible at that. Like, yep. like, okay, my former boyfriend, like, he could listen to 10 different audio streams at the same time and comprehend all of them in his brain. I mean, I'm exaggerating, but you know what I mean. Multiple audio streams. I've never been able to do that. Like, it's just... Yeah,
and that's it. A lot of people are able to do that. It just freaks me out, and I want to learn how to do it.
Right, right, exactly.
I mean, when I'm having conversations like these with you and Misty, and I think, wait, that'd be cool if I looked that up, but I can't do that. For example, I'm listening to the conversation we're having, and I'm completely ignoring any comments if they come in. But you're probably looking at all of
them. Well, he saw mine, right?
But, well, no, I mean, did you make a comment?
Well, I did
in the private chat. Game. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
But and I was hoping someone would notice eventually. But no, for me it's easier. Stuff like that's easier if I'm working a braille display, right? If I'm talking and working a braille display, it makes it a bit easier. But having like so many different audio streams, that's why when I present, I've got a braille display in front of me, or I've got a really large type in front of me that I'm looking at, because I can't do the hearing audio and trying to and hearing other people and So. But yeah.
I want to welcome Flo Walsh to the program. She's her comment was, "They can cook and what?"
Oh, we were talking about cooking earlier, probably with Wayne Meyer thing.
Yeah, they can cook name. And open out from fire.
Something. Yes, probably has something to do with
mountain. Talking about mountain climbers.
Yeah.
Oh, right. Okay.
You guys were saying that I shouldn't trust a mountain climber to
to know how to cook.
Give me cooking advice.
Well, the question is, do they burn everything they cook out there?
No, it depends on experience jars, but...
Yeah.
But
Flo is actually going to be one of the people I interview for Meet Me at some point.
Okay.
She has her own cooking in the dark type show.
Yeah.
So okay. I actually can't wait to interview her. So it'll be interesting.
Okay.
But
there are so many iterations of the cooking in the dark concept out there. Like so many iterations. You've got the original show. You got there was like a show on ACB Radio for a while. There's
as long as it's not the fundraiser. I hate the fundraiser.
I mean, like the dining in the dark deals.
Yeah, that thing. I hate that.
It can be very much like blindness simulation.
It bothers really me. Any kind of blindness simulation really bothers me.
I mean, oh my God, yes.
It's going to be a whole topic for another show. I know, right? That thing really bothers me.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Get us going on that.
Wait, I'm curious. What bothers you about that?
It's just a lot. Like not, it's just not, it's not the reality. It's just not the reality on so many levels.
Yeah, so how long does it take a person to learn to live when they're with blindness?
At least 6 weeks at the least. So, something like that.
There's research that people fear blindness more than pretty much anything else, including cancer.
Yep.
So now you put a blindfold on somebody and say, here you go, let's eat. What do you think they're going to be feeling? Because it's certainly not going to be what I feel when I eat when I'm blind.
Right. Yeah, and I mean, if they don't have the proper... The big part of it is if they don't have the proper training, they are not... They're going to feel fear, panic, pity, all of the horrible things we don't want people to feel.
And they haven't learned
the techniques for eating while they're blind. They're probably going to make a mess.
Yeah, that's true. Exactly. And they're going to... incompetent.
And they're going to assume even more so that this is what all blind people should be expected to do when they eat.
Yeah, that's true as well.
Yeah, and the worst part is people think that they understand... what blind people go through based on a couple of hours just 1 hour.
And it's all about getting a few dollars in a stupid agency's pocket. I hate it. I don't even... Never mind. we should get off that topic.
And plus, it needs a lot more time anyway, I think, like you're saying. But, yeah.
Yeah, maybe we'll have that as another topic on another day.
Yeah, I think
day.
We've ever done something like that before.
But on a final note here... to content producers who, whether you're doing podcasts, whether you're writing a book, whether you're doing a blog, it's your blog. If you want to cater to a particular audience, by all means. If you want to do it to make money, by all means, do what your audience enjoys. Our channel is for entertainment purposes, well, only. You may hear stuff that you might learn. You might hear stuff that is completely outlandish. But it's for entertainment purposes only. And it should be
the
taken.
The Blind Side for Cooking with Flo. You're supposed to send me a link at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Remember that time. I totally agree that fundraiser to me is just ridiculous. Several years ago, it was $65 a plate. God. That was the pricing for a meal for one person. Flo, I wonder, do you have that guy from the movie on your show, or is it just The Blind Side just because that's the name? Or do you have that dude from the movie on your show?
Oh, that's... Oh, yeah, I guess that would go in. Yeah.
The football player dude?
There's a football player dude?
It's a movie, yeah. The Blind Side movie.
I haven't watched that. I'm sorry.
I mean, it's kind of shocking to me that I've watched a movie that someone else hasn't watched. Yeah, it's a movie.
Well, actually, I've heard of it. I haven't watched it either, but I've certainly heard of it. And that was a lot of years ago.
It's really shocking to me. It's usually like everybody's seen everything I haven't because I don't watch TV or movies.
See,
or,
don't watch many either. So I'm kind of like, even ones that are so-called popular. Like,
yeah,
so,
I'm clueless.
Real quick, there's an ongoing series on NPR where it's like movies you missed. And they interview people, and they have them watch a movie that's really supposedly a classic that they've never seen before, and comment on it. You know, even if it's like been around for years, and like I'm a perfect candidate for that because like there are so many supposedly classic movies that I've heard of them, but I've just never had the inclination to watch them.
I'm absolutely clueless about most anything to do with entertainment.
I mean, have to say, I'm mostly into the superhero genre.
Oh, okay.
I'm clueless about that.
Oh my goodness.
Maybe if it's a book, I'll have a better chance of it. But if it's anything to do with a movie, TV show, Netflix,
well, I have to ask
TikTok, Snackchat, I don't know anything.
Did you have you listened to the Sandman audiobook?
Nope.
Oh, yeah,
or audio? Actually, it's audio play more like it.
Nope.
It's amazing. I mean, the audiobook is amazingly good, and I love it.
So for me, like when it comes to any kind of entertainment, generally, somehow it has to relate to my quote unquote in real life interests, or else I'm not mostly going to have an interest in it. Like, I mean, if it's like historical fiction from the classical era, yep, I'm all for it.
How does the classical era
you hope that
your current life?
Well, they had to have some entertainment back then,
real
right?
Real life, I mean my interests in real life. I didn't say my real life experiences, but my real life interests.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I misunderstood you there. No.
She's saying she's from classical whatever. That's like, what she's saying.
People think that I'm from another time in many cases, but you know.
She's an alien that came down from whatever, the 1500s or whatever.
Yeah,
someone literally said I sounded
like
a
Victorian.
Her
that she had an old soul because... I mean, yeah, she sounds like an 80-year-old woman in a 20-year-old body. I mean,
I actually once had someone tell me that I sounded like I was from the Victorian era when I speak. This was many years ago. This was back in high school, in fact. And
Flo
so...
says no. It's my cooking page and cooking group on Facebook and Twitter. Tweet, tweet. And I do have some videos on a couple of places.
Nimmer, I want to hire you to do this for me.
Right? Like, yeah, keep the eye on the chat and stuff. Yeah.
And don't ask me why. I just know I want to hire you to do this.
I remember that movie. Okay. All right. So I guess you're not going to have that dude on your show. All right.
Oh, dear. Wow. Talk about veering around.
So there you go, yeah. I mean, right. God, Nimmer, I hope you have tips on how you do that.
Me too.
Because I don't have the money to put you in here all the time.
I don't know if you would even have the time to do it, but...
Yeah, that's true. Especially with that for everything that's going on with Android these days.
Right.
Yep, Android 13 was just released.
Is it already fully released or is
fully
it
released.
Still in beta?
Okay. Nope, it's released. Maybe that's why I have the time to be here today. I don't know. Yeah, it's released.
So wow. You're just sitting back and looking at the damage you've wrought.
That's right.
It?
That's right.
Nice.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank Nimmer and Misty for being the wisest people I know.
Wow. Thank you. You must not know very many people.
I'm not going to lie.
Misty might be. I don't know. But,
I mean, I would call my wife wise because I have to sleep with her, but that's about it. I mean,
you have to wait, what?
His wife.
Oh, his wife. Okay.
No.
Oh, dear. All right.
So, guys, I want to thank you for joining us today. If you're so inclined, join us tonight at 9 p.m. for Snap, where we talk about
speaking of Snap,
you should masturbate before you text your ex.
If you're squeamish, have about 5 bottles of wine. I'm just telling you, guys.
Yeah.
So.
Well, yeah, we got Misty to come on the show on Snap once.
I had a bunch of wine before that, so.
There you go.
She had almost a bottle?
Almost a full bottle.
Almost a full
bottle. All right, everybody hit the like button, unless you don't like what we have to say, in which case hit the dislike button. It's up to you.
Yeah, that's true. And share it with anybody out there, especially if you think they can benefit from whatever.
Share it,
we
tweet it,
here.
Snack chap it, Facebook snack it, chap whatever you like to do.
Dear.
Feel free to visit my page too, Blind Tech Adventures.
There you go.
Yeah, and check out Misty's page too, because she's
Well,
some
I'm mostly active on, not so much on YouTube anymore, and I'd have a bunch of random crap on there.
It's a blog.
What?
It's a blog where you give lots of opinions.
Well, it's,
and that's
it's
what
like...
it should be.
And check out this Flo's Blindside Cooking, whatever it is.
Oh my God! I'm sorry. Believe me, there will be a link to Flo's page when we air her interview. Mm-hmm. So you're not left in the dark. But if you
the
want
blind
to...
side of cooking with Flo, that's what it is.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
Yippers.
Yeah, so
with Flo from Progressive, anyway.
Yeah, and
like every time I hear that name, I totally think of Dad.
I think of Alice. I mean, eat my grit.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, she never swore. That was her one swear word.
Right.
I never understood that. It was life back in the 70s. Yeah.
All right.
All right, guys, thank you for joining us, and again, welcome to the Blind Perspective. We'll talk to you later.
Been fun times.
Bye bye.
Bye, guys.
So I wonder.